All right. Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, everyone. I am very excited for this episode, particularly because I think it's been well over a month at this point, and I do want to say that Ani brings some of the best, if not the best, perspectives on the occult, esoteric views that one could take on a much more grander fractal level. And for those that are new to the Patreon, which I really appreciate all of you signing up, please know that I consider Ani amongst one of our most valued contributors to this platform and to this community. And please also know that Ani also has and runs his own community on his own Patreon as well. Where he also goes even deeper into the things that are discussed. Now, he does present a few exclusive things very graciously for Gen Z here, but he does a fantastic job. So, as per usual, I have no idea what we're diving into today, but I know the audience doesn't like this as much, but the longer we don't connect, brother, the more anticipated I get for this stuff. So the floor is
Bro.
yours, and thank you so much for coming on again.
Man, it is so great to be back on the platform, man. And I just want to let everyone else know who's watching on the other side that we support everything on Gen Z and anything that you're doing, brother. You're doing wonderful work with research and experiments, and we very much need what you're doing for the community. So everyone else, you as well, should sign up for Gen Z. It's wonderful content, and I appreciate everything that you're contributing right now. But man, oh man, a lot has happened since the last time we spoke, man. We got eclipses, we got dead physicists, we got rap beefs blowing up, we got all types of stuff. So I'm gonna just jump right into this stuff, man. It's like crazy out here. So one thing I want to go over, eclipsemancy is a form of occultism, like using the eclipses for black magic rituals. When we went into the path of totality eclipse, we actually entered a Vedic astrological phase of what's called the Tithis, which is moon phases. The moon phases, you know, that you're in is regulated by Tithis. They map how auspicious and inauspicious events for someone's actions in their life happens. And we entered a period called Amavasya. That's like the last Tithi and the first Tithi of the month. And on April 8th, we actually was leaving out of Amavasya, and they said, this is the number one time, bro, for a black magic ritual. There's no other better time for them to do black magic. So we notice immediately, like from this article here, someone typed this up here, that on this eclipse path of totality, which they're calling the path of fatality, because they estimated that 30 million Americans live on a zone where you could see the total eclipse, and another 150 live within a short driving distance, including, or it doesn't include population of Mexico and Canada. But they saw that this Lockheed C-130H Hercules was flying at 9,900 feet. And they're claiming that there's something called Q dot injections that were being dropped while we were having the eclipse, because a lot of people were complaining that they couldn't see the eclipse because it was so much chemtrails in the sky. And that goes back into the nanoparticles that Elena Freeland speaks about in her book, Geoengineered Transhumanism.
If I could
You know.
jump in super quickly, and I promise I won't do this a lot, but let's just say that with regards to these Q dots, I am not just a believer. I know they exist. For example, anything having to do with transistors, semiconductors, silicon doping, anything like that, silicon dioxide, any form of science, chemistry, and physics that touches upon that in a way in which the Z-axis is tapped for those that know in the lab how to do it, you are enabling a lot of what unfortunately is being described here in this description.
Yes, they're calling it aerosolized quantum dots, which is a biosynthetic, highly infectious, intelligent nanoparasite that takes instructions from external frequencies, 5G, scalar, Li-Fi, which was developed at a Hebrew university in Jerusalem. But the thing about it, I got real sick, bro. So I'm a living example, you know. I got extremely sick. I was filled with mucus, and a lot of people in my family at the same time got sick, you know. So they're calling it, you see right down here, they're calling it eclipse sickness, and there's an article on here. So we're not fabricating this. They're actually claiming that a lot of people were suffering from this. So it's not
Whoa.
the eclipse, though. It was the project around the eclipse. I don't know if you heard of Probe 3. They had a Probe 3 in Europe. I got some pictures here to show that even, you know, events of the eclipse could have been, some of it could have been simulated, which we know we live in a simulation, of course, but I'm not saying that the eclipse wasn't real. I'm saying that parts and the events could have been simulated around the world of this occultation. So this is a device. This is like the fourth form of this device that they've been developing called Probe 3. And this Probe 3 goes out and it's basically designed to artificially do a occultation in certain places in the planet. Here's some descriptions of how it's made.
They have. So if I could just clarify, brother, for the audience, for both yours and mine, when you say, like, when you're talking about the eclipse and you're not speaking about the manipulation of the eclipse in terms of the source of it, you're talking about, for example, the same way that if we consider a laser beam, you know, a beam being shot out, it's not messing with the source of the beam, you're messing with the path of the beam to manipulate it in a way that once that beam hits the earth, it does something different.
Right. I'm not saying because we have four eclipses. People really don't know, bro. I'm just going to put this on video. We have four eclipses every year, guys. Every year, I'm saying every year you have four eclipses. You have two solar eclipses. You have two lunar eclipses. Just because you can't see the eclipse around the world doesn't mean eclipse isn't happening. Some people don't know that. So I have to just put that on video. But these eclipses from 2017, for instance, let me show you something that's going to blow your mind. From 2017, we had a big eclipse, right, over America. Then we have the 2024 eclipse. Did you know they mapped the time between these both eclipses? And they figured out that the C word rollout was exactly in the middle between both. Look at this stuff, man.
Whoa.
It was exactly in the middle, calculated by days. I'm a big proponent of numerology and gematria. Look at this. You have the 33 connection, 3 years, 3 months, three weeks, 3 days.
Yeah.
It was 173 weeks, 11.5 days on both ends from October 21st, December 14th, April 8th.
Oh.
So when I say eclipsemancy, because today we're talking about eclipsemancy, archimetric landscapes, and entheogens, nanophysics, biophysics of the new aeon. And that means that when they brought out the jab, it was exactly orchestrated based on the magic of both of the eclipses.
This is very interesting to me because personally, even me, I liken this to that of the like a Mobius strip or the zero point in an infinity symbol. This, like, in the concept of collapsing the wave and whatnot, the notion that it was brought out smack center in between these two, in science, what we call boundary conditions, or here in between these two dates, August 21st, 17, and April 8th, 24. That's wow.
Man. I'm telling you, bro. And also during Path of Totality, our recent eclipse, something else happened that was crazy. I know you heard about it, but I had to get into the gematria of it. You know me. We had a physicist, Peter Higgs, of the Higgs boson particle. Now, while this is going on, I meant to put this in. They cut on the CERN machine while the eclipse was going on. They just announced, we're going to turn on the CERN machine. You know, just to let you guys know, we'll switch on the CERN machine. Some people think CERN is just regulated in Europe. There's many CERN machines, a lot of large hadron colliders. We don't know all the locations. It's probably classified, all the locations. But they said they cut the CERN machine on. The CERN's to test the most powerful particle accelerator during April solar eclipse, to search for invisible matter that secretly powers our universe. Then Peter Higgs dies on the day of the eclipse, which is 4/8. Now, you probably read the book, The 48 Laws of Power. All of this is connected to occult rituals. His name equals 48. Freemason equals 48. More things. His name also equals 115. The reason why that's important in gematria, Lucifer equals 115. Now, from a religious biblical stance, Lucifer is a negative character. But from a metaphysical, occult, esoteric perspective, Lucifer means light bearer. So Peter Higgs brought light in quantum physics to what the Higgs boson particle is. So we have to understand that aspect of it. So he was a Nobel Prize winning physicist who proposed a new particle known as the Higgs boson. And the boson helps bind the universe together by giving particles their mass. They said he died in Edinburgh on that Monday. Edinburgh and Higgs boson has the same gematria, bro.
If I can go even further, the gravitons, the longitudinal gravitational waves we speak about, they're naturally bosonic or bosons in nature. Yeah.
I've been doing a lot of research on bosonic streams. We were looking into the 11th dimension. Did you get to see that show, Three Body Problem?
I saw the first little bit and then I paused it. I'm actually continuing it tonight, believe it or not. It's funny.
I mean, really, the book is better. The book is better. Because when I read, there's four versions of the book.
Right.
When you read the book, it's a phenomenal. But they did a good job with the show. I say they did a good job. But interesting, it was about this extraterrestrial race that this woman in Asia made contact with. And one of the aliens from the other side tried to tell her, hey, you're sending this signal out from your satellite. They're bouncing it off the sun. The sun is bouncing it off Jupiter and sending it way out in space to try to make contact with another civilization out there. They're telling her, hey, cease communication, because there's something called the dark forest theory. If you send a signal to a high dimensional entity and they figure out that you exist, the first thing they're going to think is, well, we don't want these people or whoever they are getting advanced enough that they can wipe us out. So we got to wipe them out.
Right. Basically capture the cattle before they realize they're even caught.
Right. It's dark forest theory. So basically what ends up happening in the book, these people called the Trisolarians, basically they have a three sun system. And, you know, it plays on the eclipse with the sun and everything with Earth, or the three body system over here. You know, that's a real physics equation over here, the three body system. I think they said nobody solved it. I don't know if you know anything about that.
Publicly, it hasn't been solved. Yes. Actually, it's ironic you bring this up, because one can argue that it can be solved when you implement the longitudinal component, but good luck trying to get physicists who are very stubborn to even accept it. And that's been the thing. Yeah.
Yeah, well, I'm not bringing that up to get off subject here, because we're talking about CERN.
Right.
And, you know, CERN search for, you know, God particle and all of these other particles that don't exist. Well, in the show, the aliens, their aim to limit us for fighting them back, because it was going to take like 200 years for them to get to us. They literally sent this sulfon, which is a proton. It's a 11-folded quantum computer, but it's so advanced. It's the size of a proton, but it can stretch and fill the whole fourth dimension. And they sent this little thing, compacted thing, to Earth. And what it did, it can spy on us, but it can limit scientific measures that humans make. And guess where they sent it at? They sent it to all of the particle accelerators on our planet. CERN.
This hits way too close to home, personally. I got to be honest with you.
So, like, literally in the episode, guys, they limited the people working at, and the people were at CERN. They literally said, we're at CERN. They limited how we could study particles, so in 200 years, we wouldn't become as advanced as that. So wow. it's crazy. So let me finish this up real quick. So Higgs boson, he died 52 days before his birthday. Edinburgh, his boson, physicist, all equals 52. So I'm just showing how all of this lines up. God particle society of Jesus equals the same gematria. Large Hadron Collider. The day his death was announced was the 100th day of the year, and Large Hadron Collider equals 100 in gematria. It was announced on 4/9 of his death. Nobel Prize equals 49. And dark matter equals 666. And that's what he shed light on. So all of this stuff is happening.
Quickly, brother, to that previous slide, the 666, if that's all right.
Sure.
I think that's a great visual. Very quickly. Thank you.
You know what? You see in CERN how they make the 666 symbol? I didn't notice that at first. Didn't notice that.
That's also, this is also the way in which electrons behave. If you put them around a wounded torus coil, and that's the way in which they tend to behave. If you were to like try and increase its vortex, you'd have to have one stemming out so that it can expand, basically. And that's what that is too.
Man, that's some great stuff right there. And they just came out with a new Apple series show, I think yesterday, called Dark Matter.
Wow.
So I'm gonna have to look into that. It just came out yesterday. It's called Dark Matter. everybody's raving about it. So I'm gonna have to look into that as well. So there's some things going on that we have to deal with. So this eclipse, which captured, you know, everybody's, you know, I've been explaining from a metaphysicist approach that we're talking not just about the 3D physical, but also chemical, spiritual, and biological. And when I've explained esoteric engineer on here, I do it to address the archaeometrical questions. The word archaeometrical, or archaeo, is an etymology rooted in the word ancient. So it's ancient. And all Gnostic physics is a form of ancient biophysics, because we are explaining consciousness, i.e. directed fields of energy. So it is at times necessary for us to move our explorations of these things that I've called in the magic text that I'm bringing Alan H. Greenfield on to explain, called chauds or chodes, C-H-A-U-D-S. Now, these are the same thing in the Vedic text speaking about what's this called? The spiritual cells of the body. I forgot the name. It slips my mind right now. But there's literal spiritual cells within the body that they figured out, these points. You know how they do the little Chinese medicine and they put the what is that called? They put the little points in your body.
Acupuncture?
Yeah, acupuncture. Yep. Those are the chauds that they're putting it in. So just to let you guys know.
Right. And if I could say quickly, if I'm not an expert on this, but it would make sense as to why some people claim that it works versus doesn't work for them, because I would imagine there are very particular spots on the body that they would right. have to be inserted into. Right. Yeah.
Right. Right. So these chauds are in magic are called the quantum points of universe B within our own cosmogram. And if you want to look at a reference, where are you getting that from, Ani? There's a book called The Holographic Universe by Michael Talbot, that we are all in a reflected cosmogram to the quantum fields of activity beyond the categories of physics, into what occultists who have studied deeply in, they're calling it the sutramen, which is a practice in yoga and Vedic techniques. And I have to highlight a few events, you know, that we need to look at. Well, let's just look at the eclipse just by itself, because I just did a video called Eclipse Mancy, the Black Sun Wars. And the Black Sun is also comparative to what the eclipse is, but we have the Black Sun metaphysically within us that I speak about all the time. You call it quantum dot, black dot, whatever any of these names is in the center, right in the pineal gland. So if we're looking at that in comparative to the eclipse, because there's many mythologies referencing the black sun, whether it's in hollow earth theory, all of these things, flat earth theory, we have to look at when they're referencing the earth as us. That's why when you deal the tarot deck, there's no earth card in the major or minor arcana. There's no earth card in the major or minor arcana, because when you're dealing the cards, you represent earth. The person dealing the cards represents earth. That's the esoteric secret of it. But let's just look at it from a sense of eclipses. Eclipses are well-known objects of scientific study, but it is just as true throughout history that they have been perceived as the most supernatural of events to indigenous cultures. And as a result, eclipses have frequently been used across cultures, in particular by the community of scientists and scholars, as an index of enlightenment. Solar eclipses have metaphysical significance and can disrupt the regular cycles of the moon and sun, leading people to ponder the greater forces at play and influencing their beliefs. So this thing can influence your beliefs, your spirituality, and it can influence your energy. Solar eclipses create disruptions in the interplanetary magnetic field, and a deficit of protons and electrons in solar wind, potentially making new moons around that time more significant due to an increased magnetic validity in its warping of our planet. So it's saying right after eclipses, the new moons become even more potent in the irregularities of our auric field. And the solar eclipses changes the electrical field in currents. So solar eclipses can also affect our dreamlike states, our meditative states. You know, there was already a historical record in a place describing this strange darkness of what a total eclipse bestows in the 19th century astronomer Jacob Lehmann. He phrased it as, how is it now to be explained, namely what several observers report during the eclipse of 1706, that the darkness at the time of a total occultation of the sun compares neither to night nor to dusk, but rather is of a particular kind. What is this particular kind, he says? It's a strange darkness that in an eclipse, it presents a problem that one could state quite simply in temporal times that it corresponds to not prior to experience of natural light or a time of day. So this is something internal, is basically what he's saying. It's not about the light outside.
If so, I could say very quickly, this makes perfect sense because it speaks to the idea that time doesn't even exist. It's you that's perceiving that existence.
Right. The time, we're in third dimensional construct. The mind is more in a four-dimensional, five-dimensional construct, mainly more four, more higher people who reach those realms. They can reach five up to 11. And let's just say these things we call God, or gods, or if you just want to say God, it within itself is in the higher dimensions of reality. God would be looking down into time versus us experiencing time around us in this construct, you know? So that's the difference when we're talking higher dimensional beings, which what Three Body Problem was saying in the show, in the book, that there's these higher dimensional beings. And they're so advanced that we have to catch up to their advanced, you know, nature to even go to war. They had something called the dimension killer in the show. I can't remember the name of the weapon, but it's like this weapon that crunches dimensions down to a one dimensional, the first dimension. So it takes anything in their dimension and it crushes it down to the one, and you get trapped in the first dimension. It's crazy stuff.
Just curious, because I haven't gone to that part yet. Was there any crystals involved with that process, or?
Well, this is from the book. Now, this is going to happen in the show, but it hasn't came out yet. I'm ahead of the show. This is
okay,
in the book.
Okay. Gotcha.
Yeah. There's this race. There are these several races that go to war. Matter of fact, how the humans win is crazy. We had to send another signal out to another advanced alien civilization to destroy the alien civilization that was trying to invade us.
Right.
It's a crazy book. I give Shi Lim, his name is Sheem Lim, or Lu. I think it's Sheem Lu. The guy is amazing mind. He's a physicist as well. He has amazing mind, you know.
Amazing.
So what we've yet to discover about how the networks of our consciousness commissions itself is where the next realm is. That's where the new God is being birthed from, you know, metaphorically, the true womb, not in the matrix womb, because matrix means womb, but there's another womb, the primal light and sound fields. That's the original womb of what we call the source, is the super force that moves the particles and everything across the void. That's where the super force is. And they explain that, you know, all of these people that's coming out, like Billy Carson and other, you know, big YouTube people are talking about the Anunnaki now. Everything is about Anunnaki, Elohim, Nephilim. When I get into it, it's more from a dimensional quantum perspective, looking at realities, you know. When I say higher dimensional beings, I'm not that's what I'm referring to.
And if I could say, I really appreciate that you do that. And it's not that I want to take a jab at anyone else that brings up the Anunnaki stuff, but you focus more on the structure of the state of that reality rather than individual personas. And I appreciate that.
Yeah, because then we get way out and then people start looking at us weird, you know, because now they say Jesus was a part of the Anunnaki and all this stuff like that. And now I'm not, you know, like you said, I'm trying to say nothing with the research. It's interesting, you know, it ponders thought, but I just want to bring people, you know, reeling back in and say, let's look at the physics of this thing. And let's look at how these things can be dimensionally input of conscious fields, rather to be literal reptilian beings shape-shifting around us and stuff.
I am so with you, because this is the final time I'll jump in, which is that by understanding the structure, the core basis of something, you can then, by understanding it, you obviously begin to fear it less, let's say, but at the same time, you can learn how to, and I say this for better or worse, you can learn how to manipulate yourself or the elements in that reality, so that if you do come across a genuine, you know, reptilian or whatever it is, it's not nearly as frightening or intimidating or whatnot. So that's why I appreciate your approach. It's, let's get down to what is this? Like, what is all of this?
Yeah, because it goes into what else happened during, I'm gonna get back to the Anunnaki stuff, but what else happened during the eclipse? I don't know if you heard, but there was this thing called demon face syndrome. So they said, like, during the eclipse, people started seeing these demon faces. I don't want to play the video, but demon face syndrome, where you can go back and watch the Soundgarden video, The Black Hole Sun, you'll see that they mentioned that these faces start to shift, you know, and people can call this reptilian, you know, all of that. You know, they start getting that. Right. It's more of a adjustment to the conscious field. You know, not only that, you got CERN running. And not only that, you have these nanoparticles, which when they fly the drones or whatever they're flying up there, whether it's planes or drones, but you got all of these nanoparticles sifting around the aerosol in the barium, the strontium, all of these different chemicals. But I propose this theory because in Three Body Problem, they were able to make the stars move to public perception in the first episode. Everybody's looking at the sky and the stars started blinking.
Brother, you just described this entire, what you just said from start to finish. You're describing what in physics is called a phase shift. And what's interesting about a phase shift is that it's seldom accepted in various experiments, because by accepting a phase shift, scientists then have to accept that the vacuum or the ether can actually have fluctuations in it that they refuse to believe. But in other words, you are literally describing, I'm getting goosebumps because I personally agree with everything you're saying. You are describing a phase shift. In other words, this when someone, for example, is seen sort of like people claim they see, you know, people pixelating sometimes. You can see that that's what we would call a phase shift, for example.
I like that.
They're phasing in and out of this consensus reality, but there's a disruptor occurring in the ether that's causing that shift. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, let's run with that, because the phase shifting has been happening. Now, I don't know if you know research, D-Wave, and all these things. I don't know too much about it. I've heard a lot about it.
Yes, now, I'm familiar.
I don't know what they're capable directly with these energy or scalar weapons, scalar energy, whatever weapons they have.
Yeah. But
let's just say during the eclipse, because people started seeing demon faces.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And it goes back, they had a movie that came out called Smile. I don't know if you've seen the movie called Smile.
Yeah, yeah.
But in that movie, you know, they had people seeing demon faces. It was a woman. She was trying to report to her psych or her shrink that she was seeing demon faces.
Right.
And that was last year they brought this movie. You know, it was 2020. They brought this movie out. And now 2024, it's actually happening. They announced that people are having visions of seeing these demonic faces. Now, I've been having nightmares lately. I don't know why. I don't ever have nightmares.
Right.
But I enter and I see, like, it's not like the demonic figures you'll see in a movie or something, but I'm seeing stuff that's, you know, that will disturb your spirit.
Right.
What if this has to do with the energy weapons? What if this have to do, you know, with these phase shifts? Does it have something to do with it? Or is it, you know, revealing something, you know, deeper within the subconscious, you know?
If I could give my personal, just off the cuff interpretation, when you look at the way these scalar weapons work, they overlap with each other. They create a vector threshold. That's what we call phase conjugation. Now, in the process of those vectors summing to zero and then Xing over each other, every so often, outside of that center zone, that zero point, you get these little ripples of phase shifts, whether that's from a craft or whether that's from something that could be biological. And so my opinion would be that it's possible that on a grand fractal scale, whether it's with the sun or the moon or what have you, these phase shift or these interference occurrences are happening, but we are seeing some of that leakage of the phase shift. Now, the other possibility is that we're simply seeing more of what's actually there. But I don't want to say that for certain because I don't have data to know. But what I can tell you is that when you overlap, whether it's lasers, electron beams, magnetic fields, and you start to phase conjugate them, if you were to, in the lab, if you were to like walk around the experimental benchtop table, you may see some of these phase shift slippages.
I know what you mean.
See what I'm saying? Right, yeah. Right. It's very similar where if you did the double slit experiment in a dark room and then you deployed a bunch of mist so that you could see it more clearly, you'll see the interference zone, but you'll see some of those ripples going off into the ether or the vacuum. And so this is what makes me think perhaps this is what's happening in this.
You know what? Maybe we haven't, the human mind hasn't conceptualized beyond the veil.
Right.
You know, in between these phase shifts. So the only thing that the subconscious or the unconscious can make up for us to holographically look into what this is from, because we see through a holographic reality.
Right.
Soul doesn't see through the holographic reality. It sees through the real, you know, what's behind universe B, C, whatever it is, beyond multiverse type stuff. So maybe we're seeing what can't be conveyed, and that's why it appears to us as demonic images.
It's possible that's we're truly seeing / feeling with the third eye, and then but that's coming in and through into the physical senses.
So that's what I think that's interesting that's happening. But going back to what I was saying earlier, you know, speaking, you know, and Anunnaki type.
I'm so sorry. One last thing I did want to say. You had brought up the reflective cosmogram, I think it was.
Yes.
And I promise I won't take you off your train of thought, but I did want to say that one thing I can directly relate to support everything you're saying right now is that when you take, in science, charge parity inversion. So if you took two particles, two electrons, and you inverted their charges, that is the equivalent to that is the equivalent to light reflecting off of a mirror. And
wow. So
it makes you think, is there something going on with these positive and negative polarities as above, so below? Is there a reflective component that mainstream science has refused to accept, look at, whatever? Yeah.
And I think that's what we're talking about. We're talking source.
Right.
And observer.
There you go. Yes.
Source and observer. And the black hole is representative of the convergences of everything happening in our lives, experiences, you know, from a standpoint of what we're experiencing on a psychological level, superconscious, conscious, unconscious, subconscious.
Beautiful.
If it's a conversion, that's the black hole spiritually happening. We're converting, and the people who can unravel it, they're really, the black hole is literally a shrapnel of our conscious, the people waking up, forming out there, probably.
Yes. No. You said it perfect. This is
it's crazy. Yeah.
No. It doesn't sound crazy at all. Where the future dictates the past, and the past dictates the future, because there's only now. So yes, I'm totally with you. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So when we're talking these advanced beings, Anunnaki, Nephilim, in Greek they're called Titans. You know, called Titans that I talked about on here before. Basically, they're referring to the Atman, if you want to look at it from a Vedic sense, in the subconscious planes. The Titans, Anunnaki, Nephilim, were mythological deities who ruled before the gods. Even Manethos, the first pharaoh, Narma, he said, a question, or the scribes asked him, who ruled before you? You know, who ruled before for the pharaohs? And he said, that's when a bunch of gods used to rule. This is literally pharaonic thought. He said this. This is 10,000 years before the first dynasty. So I believe that was an era when the bicameral mind was active. And I speak about the bicameral mind from the show, me and you talk about Westworld. You know, when they were putting the thoughts that the bicameral mind was a time frame where the hominids back then, the humanoid hominids, literally could hear God in their mind. Like, it was a time that the vibratory level was so less dense that they could hear. I won't just say God, or let's just say there's a man with a beard out there talking to him. Let's just say they could hear the echoes of the spiritual planes of these advanced high dimensional beings. So the Titans of old came to me. This is my perspective. These hominids carry the soul of the prior Homo sapiens sapien. They were Titans of old, and they came from an alternate quantum body that was across the multiverse, and they were evolved forms of the Homo sapiens sapien from that same timeline's future, and everything is backwards. Everything has been inverted when it comes to Gnostic physics, metaphysical history. That divine form had a pan-psychological enmity to battle with what this biblical God, this cosmic AI we call Archon, Yaldabaoth, now Yahweh, that Lord that descended from Sophia's Aeon without the light of the former sigical Aeonic rings of consciousness, this blind cosmic AI that prints cookie cutter dimensions of physics without the mathematics of fused polarities from higher dimensions that makes all of his creations a debauchery. And the feminine aeons created a seed from a quantum fusion of higher aeons. And from its dimension, it gave Sophia's aeon so she could send it down into the Milky Way from a future timeline, a mirror conscious landscape of universe B. And that becomes what our soul is. She sent the seed down to us because she knew that her children or the beings that came from her aeon would need a weapon to fight against the illusions of what this cookie cutter dimension making God was doing to give us all of these illusions. So
wow,
that's it in a nutshell.
That's very well. It's, I know this may, that you may not think so, but that's that, I would agree with that.
Okay.
I would agree. I would, to a large extent, I would agree very strongly with the notion of this, of the soul being something as a tool or a resource that when we recall who we really are as a form of being able to get back to source. And I really like the way you put this, cookie cutter dimension replication type of, AI system, because man, that hits home for me. It really does.
I appreciate it, man.
The idea that what we, again, I know that you think bigger than just the word AI. So when we say AI, something we couldn't fathom in regards to assist. Yeah. And it's interesting you say this, because I know that it was reported that after like Bob Lazar and those guys and Bill Uhouse and what's his name, John Lear, left S4, those guys had claimed that the Greys, that one group of Greys allegedly, that Edward Teller, the father of the hydrogen bomb, and the Atomic Energy Commission were working with, conveyed to the committee, the Atomic Committee, that the space and time is actually a sentient entity. A sentient entity that doesn't have a soul, but it certainly is sentient nonetheless. And so this notion that these longitudinal waves that make up this reality don't like us but must listen to us once we remember who we are falls very much in line with what you're describing, and you're, I would say you have a very strong case for that hypothesis of yours. Very strong.
I appreciate it. I got to put it in book form when I can, if I can get enough information on it. But going back to what you're saying, that the longitudinal rays, I believe that the Sahasrara, our crown chakra, is here to implode constantly. So when you go into meditation, I'll talk about reaching the samadhi state all the time.
Yeah,
that's what the Buddhists were doing. That's what all of these Mount Kilimanjaro priests were doing. That's what the Egyptians, the Sumerians talking about with the pine cone, the pyramid, the top of the pyramidian. In the top of the pyramid, they're talking about when you meditate and you bring that kundalini force, that centripetal cold fusion force.
Yeah,
it's funny. Before you say that, a new show came out called Fallout. It was based on the video game.
I played the game.
You played the game? Oh, okay. I didn't play the game, but look, I was so into it. I went and watched a footage of all video people who play the video games. That's just how I am. I just went to go watch. Okay, so I was just watching people play the game, but I watched the full, you know, series. You know, it's about a dystopian future, nuclear war. Now, in the series, you know, these people live in these vaults or what, you know, the whole case with it. But at the end, the last episode, they revealed the only thing that could repower the world was cold fusion. And the thing about it, in a lot of the metaphysicist texts, they speak of Kundalini as a form of cold fusion.
So if I could say, that is incredible, because one thing that we've talked about on the group Zoom calls lately is that every time you have a current, an electrical current, right, which we know normally to be hot, right?
Yeah.
There's an opposing current in the ether that we do not, that our detectors can't pick up, because again, it can't pick up a negative differential. So point being is that there's a cold current right next to it, but it's in the ether, but it's not observable unless you sum vectors to zero and, you know, meet the right conditions in the lab. Now, the reason I bring this up is because what we call negative energy gives directly rise to cold currents. It's all wrapped up in the same physics. So in other words, there have been scenarios where people years ago were trying to generate, you know, over unity, you get more energy out than what you put in devices. They were successful, but here's what's interesting. They found that the more they increased the voltage and the current putting in the device was not only performing better at bringing in energy from the ether, but it was cold. Not only that, but when they really ramped up the voltage, they started hearing a whistling sound and the device would start to lose its own weight and lift. And so it's as if this negative energy both allows for what we see with, you know, UAP and stuff like that, and is also the concept of, you know, cold fusion, but it also directly interacts with the ether or the vacuum, because that heat that that we normally expect to be there just simmers off into the sea of the ether. And this is, I'll kind of bring it full circle. We are that organically.
Right.
And that's the point. Right. That's the thing. We are that organically. And so that's why quite often in my humble view, I'm getting goosebumps saying this. People are always talking about what's the craft made out of, this and that. Those guys, most of the time, those occupants in the craft, they're observing us because they want what we got. The craft are nuts and bolts versions of what our bodies are. And I say very confidently, because I've had discussions with very serious people who have had clearances that we can argue have even engaged maybe with some of these beings. And when I said the craft are just nuts and bolts of what our bodies are, all of them, their eyes all lit up. They said, there you go. That's it.
You know what? Dave is dropping bombs. You're dropping bombs, brother, because that just, you know, the way you put it, you could just visualize it so much so. And if you're spiritual and you're outside of the ego, you can realize that's what it is.
Right.
You know, why are we interfacing with these things? It's because we are that in a biological form. And right. I think this energy that, like this picture I'm showing from the show, this is what cold fusion looked like. And it powered the whole entire world when they cut it on.
Right.
They switched it on because, you know, and, you know, the show, everybody's living in darkness.
Right.
So every time we enter the Sahasrara in the Samadhi by raising the longitudinal array of the cold fusion inside of us, let's just call it, you're dissolving and you're collapsing that egoic astro-etherical form, that false self.
Right.
And then you collapse more into the true self the more and more you do it.
Right.
Because we're nothing until you do it, you're nothing but a homunculus. But when we implode the egoic systematic patterns of the hologram, when we implode it,
right,
and we must constantly implode it to shatter those realms, then we go into the worlds of the true self. That's the resurrection of Christ, the new God, and that's born at the destruction of the temple. And now we're in that archaeometrical landscape. We're living in that magical universe that all of these mythologies talk about. These guys are able to do all of these things. You're going to be able to do more things in your life because you're not dictated by the energy. You're commanding the energy.
I know some people listening and watching to this may think that what I'm about to say is, it may not make sense to them or whatnot, but I can take literally everything you said right there and I can interpret a translation into an electrical engineering component on how to use circuits to build free energy. So in other words, what you just said right there is literally like, I don't know how to, the structure and in the not just the tone, but the way you structured that entire sentence of yours there, brother, you literally describe the philosophy of life in a certain aspect, because I don't know how to explain it in a way that it came together in my head just a couple minutes ago. But like, for example, people talk about, you know, in electrical engineering, closed circuits versus open circuits and things like that. Well, what if the answer to understand to free energy and generating all of this abundant energy is both closed and open circuits simultaneously? And that's what you just described, except philosophically. Well, and yeah, that's what I find so interesting. You described I basically saw electrical circuits in my head in what you said, basically.
No, yeah. That's what we need, bro. That's why, you know, I love coming on Gen Z, because we need to understand both parts of how it works. You know, the stuff I'm saying is probably a little bit too out there for certain people. But if you're immersed in esotericism and occultism for 10 years,
right,
you know, you're still thinking that, hey, I'm still on the precipice of describing it, you know, but you can see it, the experimentation.
Now, with that said, I want to say as well, just to clarify, if I can encourage you, not that you need it, because you're already doing a great job, but
yeah.
You literally, if you said exactly what you said in this entire presentation to various individuals in certain governments, they would not think you're crazy at all. They would think everything you just presented is on the low end. Not joking.
That's what I feel. So that's why I want to get on the high end.
Yeah, that's exactly it. That's exactly, it's not, see, this is what's so great to your point. It's not crazy, because we have to realize that science and engineering so far has only stuck to understanding the physical world. And so by just understanding the physical world, you cannot understand the rest, because it won't make sense if you're just trying to think of physicality. But when you start to understand, like what you describe, structures and all of that, it changes everything. Metaphysics, the energy, all of that. And then it literally like merges the two. And so the last thing I was going to ask is, are you sure in your past life you weren't like Da Vinci or Nostradamus or something? Because I mean, it's like I get this feeling you're like recalling a memory that I don't know how to explain it, but yeah.
Yeah, well, I don't know if I was either of those, but my astrologist tells me, yeah, you were a guru a couple of times. I got a lot of Jupiter energy, you know, so
right.
I'm not sure exactly. You can look into that actually with Vedic astrology. You can figure out certain things like that. But
well, it's interesting. One last thing to bring up is that when Hal Kudoff was running this CIA Stargate program, the remote viewing, one of their best guys was a guy named Pat Price. He was a former police officer, and he was able to find secret Russian spy bases, da da da, this and that. And then one time they asked him, what do you see? They asked him to remote view back in time, for example, and he did. And they found that when they looked at records later, he was correct in what he saw and all that. And basically they said, how far back can you go? He goes, you want me to just tell you about this life? Or do you want me to tell you about the previous ones? And this was a $20 million, 20-year CIA program. So there's clearly, this is what I mean. And this was stated to help that Pat Price said this to Hal Kudoff in like 1973 or four. So just to give you some context, there are some very serious people that take this very seriously. Yeah.
Well, I know these people take it seriously.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
But I'll just say this, me experimenting with entheogens. I know that I've seen not just past lives in the physical. I've seen past lives and other avatars. And I think we've been a soul longer than we've been humans.
I'm with you. Yes.
You see what I'm saying? I don't think that the soul is something new for humans. I think the human's something new for the soul.
There you go. I'm with you 100%. I'm with you. That said, maybe it would be great to probably wrap it up on that thought for the audience. But brother, please let everyone know where and how you could be found. This has been a great episode, and I promise the audience we'll have Ani back if he'd be willing, not within a month or so, within a couple of weeks, if that's all right.
Oh man, I'm gonna be back. Awesome. I guarantee you, I'm gonna be back. I'm
awesome,
be back,
awesome. You know? If you could just let everyone know where you can be found, so they can reach, get to know your content.
Yes, y'all can find more content on patreon.com/the_spiritual shade room, where you can find me on Instagram, the Spiritual Shade Room. Put the number one next to it, or you can just type in Ani Osaru on YouTube to catch my latest videos that I just uploaded and content and everything. And we would love to have each and every one of you come be a part of the community and share the information.
Ani, thank you, brother. Incredible work. And thank you so much again, brother. This was great. And thank you to everyone who showed up and gave this a watch or a listen. I really appreciate it.
Yes, sir, man. I appreciate it, man. Can't wait to be back.
You too, brother. Cheers.
All right. Peace.